Hey, it's Brian Oak, along with my good friend, Brianne Burdett, from City's 97.1's Morning Show. And this is really cool, actually, because there are a handful of artists that come along every year, even though they've been around for a long time, that sort of help define the nature of the music that's expressed that year, right? Like literally help articulate our culture. And I don't mean to overstate it, but there are artists that are in the right place at the right time. And I feel like Kacey Musgraves is one of those artists this year. Her most recent release, Starcrossed, is easily one of the most critically acclaimed of the year. And although she's been making music for a very long time, I feel like this record is the right record for this moment and where we are and what we're doing and how life is working. And we're super lucky to be joined by her. Hi, Kacey. How are you?
Hi. Good morning, everyone.
Yeah. Well, it's nice to see your face and nice to talk to you. The new record is called Starcrossed. And as the name might suggest, now, again, I'm not a deep detective, but I have heard the record. It comes from a place of change and I don't know, conflict might not be the right word, but obviously star-crossed is not an ideal situation to find oneself in, but that's often the crucible where some really important art is born. Is that, I mean, when it comes to articulating what you're trying to say on Starcrossed, was it difficult to find the words, to find the music, or did it all come pouring out of you?
Oh, it just, this record more than any, I think almost fell out. It just needed to happen, you know? So I was really lucky to have that as an outlet for me during a time that was full of a lot of change.
And so you write this, but I mean, it's more than just songs about change, right? You find the right producers, you find the right way to articulate yourself. You create a truly great work, and then you also marry it with this video piece, right? I mean, you decide to add elements that haven't necessarily been characteristic of what you do prior to this. Why did you decide to make the sort of accompanying film that goes along with it?
I love visuals. I love creating a world that, like, you know, you can join and feel. And I just, you know, on prior records, I just have made like a music video or here or there, and that's fun and that's fine. But this one, I just feel like the drama of the story, the tragedy, you know, the arc of the story, the textures of the music that I used, how I saw it all in my mind and how it came together just was begging for, you know, a visual representation too. And, you know, I love fashion, and working with the director Bardia Zainali was incredible. I'm a huge fan of his. It was just another way for me to tell the story, really.
How much of that was your concept or kind of your baby in terms of the artistry that you wanted to kind of portray within that? Because I got to see it in the theater when it came out, and it was just such a good way to, it was really fun. So I'm kind of trying to control my fandom because I am a huge fan.
Don't control it. Unleash it.
But even Golden Hour was so important to me. This is so important to me. And it just felt really cool. I mean, we don't even get to go to movie theaters that much anymore. So to sit down in the dark and watch it.
Yeah, it was fun to be part of bringing movie theaters back. I mean, I personally love a cinematic experience. I love getting popcorn, I love getting my Coke, and I love and I love watching a movie. And I kind of missed that. So that was really fun for me to be part of. But working with Bardia on the treatment, he wrote most of the treatment. But I mean, I would deliver him the music as it came, as it was coming. So he was there from, you know, the kind of the ground floor. And then I had worked with him before on other projects too, with like Troye Sivan, and another thing
for the Easy. Yeah. I love that video. Was so amazing. Yeah.
He did that video as well. And he's a brilliant storyteller. He's very cinematic. And he just gets it, and he's fun, and he's a friend. So anyway, we probably worked on, you know, writing the treatment and really tailoring the story for a good half a year before we got the chance to make it.
It really feels like you, though, even if it has the other hands in it. That's what I loved about it. So.
Oh, totally. Well, I loved that he brought in this like wildly different like kind of perspective and kind of was able to push me into some different parts of like outside of my comfort zone. But ultimately, he was there to help me tell my story, you know. Mm-hmm.
Which again, like, so I almost equate it to what a producer does when you're in the studio, right? A producer is there to push you and prod you, to test your limits, to take things away, to put things in there. And now you're dealing with a totally new medium, right? You're dealing with this visual medium, which obviously you've done videos before, right? But I mean, a full cinematic experience, there's going to be some push and pull. Would you say that's analogous? Would you say that like it's essentially the equivalent of having a producer on your record? And so there is going to be a little push and pull there?
I think so. I mean, ultimately, you know, when you're working with someone that closely, you have to really trust that they have your best interest in mind, and that they really get your vision. Because when it comes down to it, I mean, there's just so much that goes into the end result of making something like that. And I mean, it was a massive undertaking, you know.
Well, to say the very least, I mean, I have not had a chance to see it. Brianne saw it, and frankly, without being too disrespectful, wouldn't shut up about it for about the next week. Nothing personal, Brianne, but that's a good thing, right? I mean, if you get that sort of emotional reaction, that's good. So now we talk about the fact that you have an upcoming tour, right? I mean, you've got a tour on the way that kicks off actually right here in the Twin Cities over at the XL on January 19th. Tickets are already available, by the way, for those who have not secured them. When you sort of set yourself up like this, you've created a visual palette of what goes along with this music now. And so do you feel any pressure or obligation to live up to what the video has done? Or when it comes to planning a tour, when it comes to planning a live experience, and this is a fairly limited tour too, I mean, because we're all kind of just barely getting back out there, right? But mm-hmm. I mean, you have absolutely raised the bar in terms of your presentational style. How does that affect how you approach a tour?
Honestly, it just adds to the creative palette for me. And it gives me that many more elements to play with. And yeah, so this is a limited tour. There's only 15 dates. And this is my first arena, like headlining tour. I've never done this before in this capacity. You know, sure, I've been on tour and open for people like Harry Styles or Katy Perry in those situations, but this is the first time that it's like, it's my show, it's my production. And I'm can confidently say that if you buy a ticket and come to that show, you will leave having had an amazing time. It's going to be so visually stunning. The band is kicking ass. They sound amazing. These songs are going to be brought to life in a way that I'm really hoping will just be really a beautiful experience.
You talked about synchronicities kind of popping up in the production of the album, which I'm such a sucker for. So I love that. That was basically like a clickbait kind of thing for me. Do you have an example of like your favorite kind of moment that happened like that, or maybe something really just crazy in terms of just, I can't believe what a coincidence that is or something?
Honestly, we could be here all day. Like I would need to go. I would write them down constantly, but you know, it's like, I try not to be like, look for the meanings too much of the synchronicity.
Yeah.
You can kind of get like stuck in there.
A little bit.
But I mean, it really was wild. There was like constantly things like we'd have a conversation about, or like, you know, I would see certain initials on a t-shirt, or like, I would like see symbols like a lot. Like it was really, really crazy. Names of songs, like,
pushed in that direction.
Yeah. Totally. 1000%. I would see like the color lavender was a main theme throughout mm-hmm. this whole process. And then also kind of the chapter where I'm at right now in my life, like for some reason that color has been a very common thread. Yeah, I don't know. It's been really interesting. I just feel like, when you allow yourself to be opened up to like the energy that's like really meant for you, whether that's like the people that are around you or the things that you're dedicating your time to, you open yourself up to be, I don't know, to experience that you're on the right path and that you're where you need to be. And, it was crazy.
Do you feel that music finds you when you're ready, whether either listening to it or writing it? Just kind of a quick anecdote is, I was in from the get with Golden Hour, but my friend wasn't. And she went through kind of a painful breakup, went on vacation and totally dove right into it. And she was like, it was like, it was waiting for me Aww. For that moment. So it's one of our favorite albums. And so it just, did you find that with the writing process or even in songs that you enjoy that it kind of comes to you more than you go looking for it?
I think so. I mean, isn't that kind of like, I feel like how life goes in general, you know, when you're not looking for something, there mm-hmm. it is. And I don't know, that's a lot of how my ideas will come to me is when I'm not really like looking for them. They'll just hit me out of nowhere. And so then I try to notice them and write them down or whatever. But yeah, maybe it's just that your perspective opens up and changes and you kind of are allowed to receive the message of whatever it is, like more than mm-hmm. prior.
Sure.
Casey, can I, because I don't really like to dig into people's lives, but can I just ask where you're sitting right now, like what state you're in and where you're at? Because you're in this gorgeous, beautiful white room where the sun is streaming through the windows. And here in Minnesota, the gray skies are predominating and winter is threatening us. And it looks like you're somewhere like look at the giant green plant behind you. Yeah, exactly. You've got a Buddha or Vishnu thing going on here.
I've kept this fig tree alive. Like it's been like my proudest achievement. Like when I moved across this fig tree was here and it's pretty freaking massive. Like, I don't know. I was like, no pressure to keep this thing alive. And like, I would feel really bad about myself if this thing died, but no, I'm in my dining room right now.
Do you live in Texas?
No, I'm in Tennessee.
Tennessee. All right.
I guess it's like, where do I live? I'm like kind of everywhere. Texas, but yeah, so this is my like little Zen den. I try to keep, I think this is like maximalist up here in the birthday, so I try to keep my surroundings minimalist.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
You're one of my favorite follows on Instagram too. I love your story. It's kind of just part of my daily routine. Some of my friends will be offended. I don't even look at their stories, but one of the first things, it's like, I check my notifications. Oh, what's Casey up to? And not even that in a weird way. It's just like, you have such a feel for kind of translating your maybe everyday life into this like aesthetic and visual. And I just love Pepper. I love your home. Like, I'm really like, you present yourself in a really just interesting yet still relatable and kind of digestible way. Like, I just really appreciate you. I guess that's not even a question. That's just a compliment. Right, so, aww.
Laying by the fire. She's
I love her personality. Yeah, exactly.
She's a blue healer. If anybody out there has a blue healer, yeah. You know, I feel like I need to go like Blue Healers Anonymous. Cause I'm like, these dogs are crazy. Like, I did not know what I was signing up for. But she, you know, they're cattle dogs. They want a task. And if they don't have mm-hmm. a task, they're going to find one.
So, jumping in on that, I have a friend who's on his third blue healer and I've known him for 30 years. So, I mean, he's had these dogs their entire lives. I was going to say, I've never seen a blue healer that immobile in my entire life, because like you said, they need a job. They want a job. They're not happy unless they are corralling something or chasing something or figuring. That is the mellowest blue healer I've ever seen in my entire life.
It's this weird like hack that I've figured out that if I put the fireplace on, she's like in a trance and she like has to like lay by it like a cat or something. So I'm just kind of like, I'm going to go with that. I'm trying to get her ready though, to go on the road with me in January. She's never been on the road. She's never been on a bus. So it'll be really interesting to see, you know, how, how she does with that. I don't know. I might be just dropping her off in your city. If you see Pepper, there, that's what happened.
We'll be good stewards.
Yeah, exactly.
Real quick to wrap it up. I know we got the tour, we got the movie. The one thing I want to ask you lastly is, to me, talking to an artist about their process is endlessly fascinating, right? So obviously you go through a lot for the inspiration for these songs. You work with trusted advisors and companions, but you always meet new people. There are songwriters coming in to collaborate. And then you add the whole visual element and there's a lot there. You've created a very sort of set, definitive thing, right? But do you ever find yourself sitting around the house, maybe there in your Zen area with your blue healer, and be like, oh man, you know what? I could have done this on that song, or maybe I should have added this, or maybe, I mean, like, do you second guess, or are you able to be comfortable with the quality of, nobody's going to argue that the quality of what you created is very high level, but as an artist, I imagine you're never quite done with it, right? You never quite want to be finished messing around with it.
I mean, you know, that's the thing is you could kill a work of art by just overworking it. And just, you know, I mean, it's crazy. You know, there are artists out there that like will mix a record for like years. And I'm like, I don't know how you do that. I would lose myself and I would go crazy just tweaking this album until it doesn't even look like what you started with. So I do think that for me anyway, there's kind of a point where, you know, you need to step away and and be happy with where it's at. I mean, sure, you can always look back and go, oh, you know, I could have done this or that or the other, but I try to not let myself get to that point. Like if something's bothering me enough to where, like if a vocal is bothering me or like, you know, a guitar part or like an effect or something, and it's kind of rubbing me wrong, like every time I hear it, then and I try to go, you know, will this bother me later if I don't fix it? And cause I'm a fixer naturally. Like I can be a perfectionist in a lot of ways. And so, yeah, I think just finding that right balance of like, all right, I need to step away now, you know? But no, I think genuinely, like, I get things to where I'm really happy with them. And then I try to like, let them go, you know? Cause yeah, you could just make yourself totally miserable if you just like, just keep on and keep on and keep on. You know, and like, it's weird. I've made records. There was one that I made that we tried to do in like a matter of a handful of days, you know? And then there's like Star-Crossed or Golden Hour where we spent like several weeks making it and then getting into the mixing process or whatever. And it's like, there's no wrong way to make a record. On one hand, whenever you are kind of moving quickly, you kind of move like based on gut instinct, and there, that's one way to do it. But I kind of like having a little bit more time, not too much time.
Well, I mean, that's why I ask virtually every artist I've ever interviewed that question, because I don't know how you know when to say when. Obviously you hear it and you're like, that's amazing. And then 2 days later, you're like, you know what we could do though? And so right. It's always a mind bender to me. So
no, it's how did like, you know, how did Matisse or like Picasso like go, okay, put the freaking paintbrush down. Like, when, right. I mean, it's like, if I, anytime I paint, like the shit ends up like it's just a black blob. Cause I'm just like, all right, now I should have stopped 30 minutes ago.
Well, luckily you've shown a little more restraint with your music. Star-Crossed is out and widely available. There's the accompanying film, which is also available. And the Unveiled Tour is going to be coming to the XL to kick things off night one, opening night, January 19th.
Yes. And you come see us. We have Muna and King Princess.
King Princess.
I'm such a fan of both. And it's going to be like, I just think a really like wonderfully like inclusive, fun, beautiful mm-hmm. night. A lot of wonderful females on tour, a lot of like, you know, female musicians and a lot of like eye candy too. There's going to be a lot of really pretty visuals and things like that. So please come see us. It's only 15 dates. And I, you know, I'm kind of nervous. It's been a while since I've been on the road. So bring all your good vibes and come hang.
Casey, thank you very, very much for the time. I know that you're building up to a crazy 2022. And I know on behalf of Brianna and myself, we wish you the very, very best.
Oh my God. I really, really, truly appreciate both of you guys' support. And I hope I'll see you whenever I roll through.
You will. Thanks so much. It was so nice to meet you.
Thanks, Casey.
Have a great day. Bye.